Welcome everybody to the fifth day of Multidisciplinary Research Week. It's our second last day today, so thank you all for coming along. And it's my pleasure to introduce you to Simon Kemp, Emma Waight, and Ellie Tighe. Today they're going to be talking about a very important issue on consumption, not only in the retail section, but also in the fashion industry. And as we've been learning this week, consumption is very important for us all as a community and individually, as we've learnt that our planet and as a population, we're more and more exceeding our planetary boundaries in the amount that we consume. So it gives me pleasure to introduce you to our speakers, who will provide an insight into these and to specifically draw on how, as an individual, you might want to change your behaviour and learn about these issues. Simon will first talk for about 40 to 45 minutes, and then Ellie and Emma would do a joint presentation for about 20 minutes. At the end, there'll be about 10 minutes time for Q&A. We've got refreshments outside, and also we've got the accompanying Be a Green Shopper workshop next door, which I hope you can come along to, be creative, and reflect again on how you can change your behaviour and work with recycling materials and what resources we have. So if we welcome our speakers today.
Good afternoon, everyone. Right, what are we going to talk about? Well, I think some of the content of this presentation is actually going to be related to you, because this is something which is so personal to people in terms of the retail sector, retail environment, consumerism. So I think it would be remiss of me to say, I'm just going to speak at you and you're going to listen just to me. Okay, so if you've got any sort of contributions, questions, as we're going through, I'm more than happy to take them as we're going through, because I've got one of my students, one of my tutees actually, in the audience, and she'll be very used to the fact that I try to get a dialogue with the audience, because in terms of multidisciplinary research, there is significant social research which has proven that there is nothing more boring than listening to a Welshman talk for a long period of time. So we need to make sure we break past that particular boundary. So what I'm going to be addressing today is the whole idea of a sustainable retail environment. And again, this is where it comes into your ideas for this, because this anything which is about sustainability has got to be very much a combined approach. It's got to be something which has got to be partnership between the provider of any particular source, but also the local community, and the so-called broad-scale idea of stakeholders, so to speak. And we are certainly all stakeholders in the retail environment. I'm going to particularly focus on an initiative that I've been working on for, I think it's 4 or 5 years now, which is working with Westquay Shopping Centre down in town. Hans, have you been to Westquay? There he goes. Yes, pretty much most people here, really. So many of you are familiar with Westquay. Tell me, have you ever heard, whilst you're walking around Westquay, they always have those little whispery safety notices and things as you're going through, and saying, in the event of a fire, please evacuate to this sort of route. Okay. Have you ever heard them actually say, in one of those hushed, whispery sort of Marks and Spencer type advert voices, in the event of environmental management, we've got ISO 14001, the international standard for environmental management. Did you know, have you ever heard them say that? Well, if you actually listen, they do. They do sometimes have over the Tannoy system. Did you know we have got the international standard for environmental management, ISO 14001? And that's something we'll come back to. So they are actually making some sort of steps towards trying to manage their environmental impact. But what I want us to consider is whether or not it is actually the correct approach, whether they are actually adopting the proper strategy. Okay? So, retail. Is retail a sustainable industry? Now, we could just leave that slide up there for 45 minutes and talk. And unfortunately for you, that's exactly what we're going to do. I've got the one slide, really, but we could. And I want you to answer some sort of questions this. In terms of sustainability, if you think of sustainability in the true holistic sense of an integration of social, environmental, and economic concerns, does that lend itself to retail? Any thoughts from the audience on this? Anybody got any opinions? Is it achievable? Can you actually have a sustainable retail environment? And this is where we get the face off of silence, isn't it? I would break you down eventually.
Where nobody needed to repurchase, then it would all break down.
That's a really interesting point, because it depends on what you actually do in terms of the repurchasing and what you do with the goods you no longer want. Yeah. Do you actually put them back in for recovery? Is there anything in the way of the reuse? Are you taking away some of the key components? Whether we're talking here about fashion, which we'll hear a lot more about later, or whether we're talking about technology. It depends on the route of return as to what you're trying to upgrade to, because essentially most consumerism is a lot of it is upgrading, whether it's the upgrade of the mobile phones, clothes, kitchenware, etc.
Yes, I'm thinking about how the software is developing, because before it was just like Microsoft just keeping everything secret, and now we are going back to the open source idea where you actually sell the support instead of selling the software. And so maybe there should be something that can be something that works better and longer, but you sell the support instead of selling another another fridge, another, like something like this.
I think it's, yeah.
A different way of thinking taken from the software developing way.
I think you're absolutely right. And if you, for example, from my view here, do you know what I can see in the audience? I can see two things. I can see people. What else can I see? I can see lots of glowing apples. All you look through the audience here, all you can see is a glowing apple. And the point with the glowing apple element of it is that it's so shiny, it's so lovely. I've got apple materials myself. But the point with them is that there is this marketing myth that they don't slow down, that they keep on going, and they're much more... They're much more robust than a Windows-based system, for example, and you don't need to replace it. But obsolescence is built into the Apple products. Would any organization, in reality, in terms of wanting to make profit, because the whole of the retail industry, everything within our particular economic model is based on consumption, it is based on new purchasing, it's based on profit, it's based on delivering profit to shareholders. Would any organization really build in a system, a piece of equipment that is going to remain robust for 10 years, rather than say 3 years? The last Apple MacBook I bought was 4 years ago. I thought it was going to last me for at least a decade or so. It's getting the point now where it's got the latest operating system, but it's so slow trying to run that operating system, even though I've upgraded a lot of the hardware within there, that I'm thinking, am I going to have to get myself a new laptop soon? The obsolescence is built into it, and there's always something newer, better, brighter, shinier, lovelier to buy.
Well, I think it's a two-way thing, isn't it? I remember when 30 years ago, I was going to work, earning 25 quid a week, paying £5 for batteries for cycling to work and back during the winter months. And that's £5 for a week. Now, a fraction of a pound battery will last my lights on my push bike for 2 months.
So there have been great improvements.
So there's that bit. So there's the bit where you have to keep upgrading because there's a cost and time factor to the person who's buying it, and yet some of the tools that I've got to maintain my house I bought 30 years ago, and they're still going strong. So
yeah, that's a really interesting point, because I mean, what you're essentially saying is that things were built to last a lot more previously, but at the same time, lots of technological advancements mean you can actually get a lot more energy out of a smaller piece of equipment. That actually means you have to reduce the amount of energy consumption you've got in terms of some of the equipment you can use. So there are improvements, there are costs. In terms of whether or not it is a particular sustainable industry, you've got to consider issues around planetary limits, in terms of it is essentially a closed system. Can you have infinite growth in a closed system? That's an issue for debate for some people. Some people might have particular strong opinions either way within that. But what you're really trying to do is to try to build in something regarding a closed loop ideal. So if you think of retail in terms of its key components, then you've got the original resource extraction and the manufacture of the product, whether it's a single component product or whether it's multi-component products, the sourcing, the different, you've also got to think of it in terms of sustainability. You've got to think of the political regimes which are sourcing many of the original materials from the ores, for example. So you've got to take the social considerations very strongly into account here. You've got to look at the cost elements. You've got to look at the contributions back to local economies. You've then got to look at the environmental cost. In terms of the natural resource extraction, that's quite large. But in terms of the whole life cycle of particular products, you need to think in terms of the whole closed loop, because closed loop systems are really what everybody's now aspiring to. This has been partly driven by a lot of scientific and technological engineering work over a number of years. The discipline of life cycle analysis applies very well to the retail environment. But life cycle analysis, cradle to grave, or it shouldn't even be cradle to grave anymore, it should be cradle to regeneration. Now, that in itself has been around since the 1970s. But more and more scientific evidence proving the planetary limits means we've actually got to try to work more towards that particular model. Equally, legislation is a big driver of this as well. Because you can't just simply have a societal ideal of moving towards a closed-loop economy, working towards closed-loop retail, different products, etc., as for what people actually aspire to and what they want. It has to be tied in the legislation, because it doesn't matter how much you might get a body of people saying they want to do something. It's actually about the control and putting the systems in place to prevent changes and to prevent moving away from the closed loop. And there are many examples of this. And the most relevant example in terms of from a retail perspective is the packaging regulations, which came through from the European Union all the way back in 1994. You had a packaging recovery directive back in 1994 because there were concerns when the biggest areas of waste generation was through constant generation of unnecessary packaging, over-packaging of goods, but not just over-packaging of goods, the actual recovery and reuse of those packaging. So they don't just get mass over-packaging and then straight in the bin, straight into the landfill. But there being legal requirements on all member states in the European Union to recover certain percentages of total packaging. The sort of figures you're bandying about here are between 70 and 80% of all packaging that goes into a country, whether it's from outside the European Union into the country or made within a country, has to be recovered, and you have to have the evidence of that. So you're already addressing one of the main areas of existing environmental impact and trying to reduce it. And then you get the WEEE regs. Has anybody heard of the WEEE regs here? Yeah, some people have heard of the WEEE regs. It's very much relevant to all these nice shiny apples we've got around here in terms of waste electrical and electronic equipment. Regulations, again, working on a closed-loop system that you've got to recover a certain percentage of all the electrical equipment that's worked, because, again, the research showed that the highest-growing waste stream and the one with the greatest potential for leaching hazardous substances out in an uncontrolled system into the environment came from waste electrical equipment. And that then links back into controls on restricting substances. You've got the restriction on the use of hazardous substances regulations, which came in at the same time, in terms of preventing those materials going into the system. Now, this is an example of where research, multidisciplinary research, in terms of looking at social elements, in terms of looking at environmental harm, and looking at future casting, actually does tie in perfectly into a particular sector, in this particular case study, the retail sector. Okay? So, this also reflects very much on, has anybody heard of the circular economy? Yeah, because some people have heard of the circular economy model. Now, it's got a lot of weight behind it as a model. It's one of these things which has been designed amazingly well. It's got a lot of buy-in from industry, which is a great thing. Industry are very much supportive of this. And the idea behind the circular economy is fundamentally closed-loop systems. But there's a lot of talk there within. You've just basically got to create systems that make it impossible for people to throw things away, make it impossible for design to be considered so you can just chuck away. It's all, everything is built in terms of extraction of key components, reuse as much as possible. But that, I would argue, is only possible through legislation. And legislation is always driven by scientific evidence. At least good legislation is, theoretically. So within the retail environment, you've got the resource extraction and manufacture. You then got the packaging and the distribution. So we've spoken about the packaging impacts from retail. But what about the distribution elements of this? When people are using some, because you can massage the carbon footprint in figures for the United Kingdom any which way you want. It depends on which system you look at it. Do you look at it purely in terms of production and consumption of carbon within the United Kingdom? In which case, we seem to be making progress towards our carbon reduction targets. When you actually consider from the retail environment, where do the majority of our products come from these days? More of the emerging Asian markets, particularly China. Do you then feel that it is correct for the Chinese economy to have its carbon emissions data tied purely to its production when the production is actually feeding the Western world in terms of products? Do we say we've got a reduction in carbon targets, but they're doing so badly for their China, they're dreadful, it's all about controlling China because they keep on making all these products and all these emissions to atmospheres, changing the climate. Where are those products going? So it's about how you do the carbon accounting through there. So the transport is actually, the distribution is a big, big factor within retail. And I want you to remember that and hold on to that, because that's something we're going to come back to later on in terms of, is this fundamentally about transport? Is something I want us to consider. You then got retail. Now, within this element of it, within the element of retail itself, then you think, well, that's fairly benign. You're just looking at, you've once you've taken all the resource extraction and you've taken all the packaging, you've done all the distribution, you've done all that travel, all it's really doing in a shop is it's just been brought in, it sits there on a shelf, it goes, hey, look at me, I'm nice and pretty, I've got nice packaging, buy me. And then somebody takes it home and they're gone. But it's not about that. This is actually an important part of the chain. If you're looking at it from an environmental management perspective, and particularly from a sustainable development perspective as well, because you've got to consider the impact on the local community from the retail environment. Now, the retail environment, the way the retail environment has gone within the United Kingdom over the last 10, 20 years is very much towards out-of-town shopping, for example. Everybody talks about the death of the high street. Now, big, massive shopping centres like Westquay, for example, they do unquestionably have an impact on the high street. They take away the diversity. It's all about, good term for this actually, came from some of our students on our sustainability module here at the university, where they did a big film on Clone Town Britain, and they were mocking the move towards all the shops looking the same, all the high streets looking the same, no diversity, no distinctiveness in the high street. And that is a concern, because you then do start having sort of cultural changes. You also have to then think about the impacts in terms of, again, it comes back to the transport. So if you've got out-of-town shopping centres, you've got the transport impact associated with them. But also, if you have a big retail centre like Westquay, right in the middle of town, what about all the transport that comes in from externally? What about all that transport that comes in for the whole of the surrounding area? Now, does that have a community impact? It certainly does, in terms of congestion, in terms of deterioration of local air pollution, in terms of local air quality. So the retail isn't just simply the product sitting there. It's all to do with infrastructure in terms of how people get there. But then when you actually run in the centre, what you do in the way of the energy consumption, where they're looking in terms of the lighting, the heating, the cooling in particular in the summer as well. That's very, very energy intensive. And what about all the operational elements of the shops? Now, what you don't see when you go into Westquay is what actually happens behind the scenes. And there's a huge labyrinth behind the scenes in Westquay where I have got lost a number of times. But I, obviously, because I'm standing here today, I did find my way out eventually. But it was touch and go a couple of times. And behind there, it's actually quite difficult to try to get a whole sense of the operations themselves. You get a much better feel for the whole waste that is generated purely from the stores themselves. And that is taken on by Westquay themselves. So the actual retail units themselves are small contributors, but they're part of the whole. And then you've got to think about the consumers themselves. What about the consumption patterns of people? Because the point you're making just now about we are encouraged to consume, and we are very much. You look at the whole of the media, no matter what element of media you look at, whether it's on the internet in terms of the rise of all the advertising banners on the internet, whether it's on the radio, if you listen to some of the commercial stations, television, cinema, wherever you go, it's basically saying, buy me. That's what it's basically saying at all times. So we are always encouraged to consume. It's then a matter of what consumption choices you make. Are you prepared to put your money where your mouth is regarding sustainable consumption patterns? Do you even consider it? Do you take it into your purchasing decision portfolio? Do you even rely on the correct information as well? Because that in itself can be a problem. And then you've got the usage when you've actually taken it home from the store. And you've got the classic example, you've got washing machines where people will talk about all the energy components and the reuse of materials to actually make the washing machine, but the general recognition that the really intensive element of its environmental impact comes through the usage. So in terms of the instructions, do you use the products with the environment in mind? Then you go back up to end of life, or preferably recovery. Can you take the components apart? Can they be reused? Can they be put back into the consumer chain? And that's when it then should link back into the manufacturer, because at that point you should then hopefully start extracting, removing the resource extraction element of it, so it goes straight back into remanufacture, refix, repair, and back through. Okay, so those are parts of the elements you need to consider when you're looking at the retail environment. Because what we really want to think about is whether or not we are going to move to a sustainable retail environment, and in order to have that, you really have to have sustainability literate consumers. People have to understand, you have to understand the consequences of all your decisions. So, for example, we were having a meeting this morning and we were talking about sourcing some products for some... an event that we're going to be doing, and we had to whisper in hushed tones about where we got one of the products from. Isn't that right, Julia? It was, you know, see, looking to see, I'm pointing the finger at the guilty parties here. We were considering what products to buy in for an event, and then you start looking at it and you think, well, actually, that has come all the way from China. Is there a UK-based alternative we can look at? So you've got to be prepared to make the correct decisions. But do you understand it, and can you get the information you want? And also then, are we going to move towards a green economy? Now, if you're going to have a so-called green economy, which is very much a government aspiration, then you do need to have a sustainable retail environment. So in terms of sustainability literate consumers, they very much link into people who are sort of, they're graduates from the school of life, so to speak, in terms of all the decisions and all the data you get from there. Because what you've really got to try to figure out here is where all the information comes from. Can you interpret that information? Can you put that forward in terms of purchasing, your destination of shopping? How many people here will go to Westquay before they'll go to, say, Bedford Place, where you do have a really nice variety of independent stores? How many of you go to Westquay first? How many of you go to Bedford Place first? Not so many of you. So how resource intensive is that decision in terms of your time? What are you going to do in terms of addressing that gap, the gap that people really don't like to talk about? Because you can get lots of information, lots of data out there through different surveys, whether they're done by Mori, OPSI, DEFRA, etc. Everybody saying, we are concerned about the environment. We are concerned about the environment. People and the public are concerned about the environment. Therefore, it's all going to be okay. We don't need to worry because people are genuinely interested and they are concerned. However, how much of the market does organic food account for? Less than 5%. So there's differences there. There's lots of research showing that value action gap in terms of decision-making processes. What we really want is to have sustainability literate consumers. They are critical to a green economy because the UK government says that they want the whole economy to be green. Now, how many people would look at that with a cynical viewpoint and think, well, that's just a way of trying to reframe growth? We're worried. The economy's in collapse. The global economy's in collapse. What can we do that's slightly different? I know, let's go green, because then we can have different energy choices and it'll all be okay. We can build our way out of it. And there's certain irony involved in that as well. Right, what I want to talk to you about now is an example of how we like to think universities, through different combined holistic research, and also critically as well through one of the main points of a university system, education, can contribute to working in partnership with some of these potentially damaging types of industries. Okay, so the emphasis here is very much on education feeding the research and education feeding the partnership as well. Because if a university is going to contribute anything, it shouldn't just contribute research conducted in ivory towers and then sent out to the world for people to read. It's got to be that whole, everybody gets involved within it. And I am a passionate believer in the value and power of students to action that change and utilising the student collective brilliance to try to push new ideas through and to get a certain critical mass so you can make the change that just one academic working with one individual, one institution, in one organisation can't achieve on their own. All right? So this whole long-term project work with Westquay very much started from my module on environmental management systems, which I teach at the master's level in the university. So it's an MSc module, postgraduate. It's been running since 1997 now, so It's been going for quite a while. Sometimes I do get elements of Groundhog Day when I'm teaching it, and I'm standing there thinking, did I say this last week? Oh no, it was last year. And that's quite frightening in itself. The whole idea here is that you have a module which is based around practice. So ISO 40001, that number that I mentioned to you earlier about them having, about Westkey having an environment management system, what I do is teach the module around students then having the skills to be able to implement an environmental management system in an organisation, but to actually do it in an organisation, so the organisation then does have the change. They can action the change that students otherwise, in previous versions, by a fictional case study, where students would actually think, well, this is kind of what we would do, but they're making it up on the basis of a load of companies that I've worked with in the past and giving them data from those. Doing it for a real company means that the company can action the environmental change, but also that the students will definitely understand it more. You learn so much more from a pedagogical perspective. You learn so much more by trial and error, trying things out, making mistakes, learning from the process and doing it for real, rather than sitting, listening to a tedious lecture and then having to write an exam on that tedious lecture. Doesn't really achieve that much in this type of work. So that was the idea. Students learn more, but critically, they also then become more skilled, and then they can take the job opportunities in this area, and then you're sort of creating a sustainability legacy from your graduates in terms of people who can go out there, go into organisations, make a difference. And it'll feed through and through and through the system that way. So that's the idea, and first year I tried doing this was 2007, where I actually used a local construction company to try to embed the employability skills in there from a real sense. But as I said, the most important outcome, as far as I'm concerned, is deal, it's student skills with employability and an organisation being able to reduce their overall environmental impact. The strategy overall was active student participation, action learning in essence, in its very truest sense. No students have got previous experience or training in the subject area in all the years that have run it. And the emphasis is very much here on education for sustainable development. And I use education for sustainable development as the catch-all term, because education for sustainable development develops the skills and the people, as well as having the wider outside impact as well. The teaching is very much aimed at creating the change, but also looking at it from a research perspective as well, because we wanted to have the overall project aim then being distinguished by straightforward lectures, getting the students working in consultancy teams. So when students are working in consultancy teams, make sure you manage the packaging from your snack appropriately. In terms of the six consultancy teams, making sure that those consultancy teams are actually buying into the whole industrial ethic, that they start thinking like a consultancy, start thinking in a business sense. Basically, I aim to destroy students and rebuild them. Rebuild them as consultants, as professional individuals who think in a different way, because when you typically get environmental scientists, they tend to think in terms of, it's all about the environment, all about the environment. Getting people to think from an industrial perspective is important from a multidisciplinary approach, because you're getting people to think in a different way that is pragmatic, that engages politicians, industry leaders, etc., etc. So get them into that frame of mind. Going and working in the company, getting lots of correspondence. The company, when I say there's a filter there, the filter is me, because the first time a student's going to work with an organisation, you don't know what questions they're going to ask them. We're incredibly lucky at the university. We get amazing students. They're absolutely brilliant. But the first time you do something, you might ask something silly. So I have to make sure everything goes through me first, and then it gets to the company. And then lots of different ways of trying to jazz it up a little bit to make it a bit more interactive, allowing sort of sharing of information in the student groups. And then getting them to do scary things, like talking to the board of directors from the company. And that is scary. See, Nabila is nodding her head, but you haven't experienced the true horror of the full version of EMS, where they have to do it for the actual company board of directors rather than make-believe me pretending to be a director. And getting big companies, get the directors to come down from London and making the students present to them in terms of the full board of directors on their own. Just putting them there and then say to them, go, deal with it. You've got to present to them what work you've done, and you've got to show how you're leading the change within there. And convincing the directors that they want to change the environmental practices. And when we've done this in the past, we've had interesting points where I think with Hammerson, the company who owned Westquay, when we'll eventually get to Westquay, I promise you. The company who owned Westquay, they sent their board of directors down. They're one of the biggest companies in the country. They're a FTSE 100 company. So they sent their board of directors down and we put the students in front of them. And I said to the board of directors, treat them like expensive consultants, hold no prisoners. And they did. they were actual tears. They did make one student cry. It wasn't intentional. It was my fault. I told them to just go for it. But students do learn a lot from that. You learn a lot from fear. You learn a lot from being put into uncomfortable environments. So example case studies. Oh, look, product placement. Ta-da, Hilden Water. We've also done, do you know about Hilden Water? Biggest natural mineral water company in the country. By a long shot, they also supply all the royal premises, everything to do with the royal family, etc. Building companies, Wilding Butler, they've since gone on to do other work with us. So we've also done Southampton City Council. We've done Southampton Hospital. This year we did Scandia, one of the biggest insurance companies in the country. So the emphasis here is targeting big companies that have got a big environmental impact, but also their big names that students can put on their CVs as well to get jobs. So this is the long-term research project, getting that body of evidence so you can lead change through education activities. This isn't your traditional research project in terms of going out and just collecting data. It's about trying to do it through education, which is a slightly different approach. Finally, we get to Westquay. So, Westquay. What do you know about Westquay? As I said, a lot of you have been there. Big shopping destination. Well, a little bit of background. It's owned by Hammersmith PLC. Hammerson. PLC, as I said, FTSE 100 company, and GIC, who are a company based out in Southeast Asia. It's got 100 shops and catering units in there, so they've got a lot of customers. And the key thing here, when you're talking to Westquay, you've got different language. Because when you say customers to Westquay, they don't think of you. Who are the Westquay customers? Shops. Yeah, exactly, the shops, they are their customers. They've got to retain their business. And the only way the Westquay can retain their business is if they create an enticing and luxurious and enjoyable shopping environment for the public to come in and spend the money so that they can pay their rent to stay there. 33-acre site, retail space, 5 times the size of a football stadium. This is an interesting statistic, I think. An average of over 1 million visitors per month. Now, you think of that in terms of the footprint of Southampton. 250,000 population in Southampton and surrounding conurbations, yeah? Not just within the city centre now, but the whole of the area of Southampton in terms of the city boundaries, which is actually quite big, that's 250,000. 4 times the population of the whole distributed population of Southampton visit Westquay on an average month. It's close to a million, it gets close to a million a week when it gets close to Christmas, for example. All right, so you've got there a quite considerable change to a community in terms of travel flow, in terms of congestion, in terms of noise, but also in terms of the overall energy consumption that goes to support those activities. And you've got 4,000 car parking spaces in there, which is a lot of cars to hold at any one point in time. And the overall catchment in terms of their target area and where the majority of their visitors come from in terms of the numerous travel surveys they've done, catchment of 2 million people within a 60-minute drive. So within a 60-minute drive, you're thinking north, east, west, and also people popping over from the Isle of Wight as well. But you're going much further west than going past Bournemouth, Poole, etc. You then start going further, deeper into Dorset. Because from there, the nearest point past there is really Exeter or going up to Bristol. So it's actually an enormous catchment area. So it's a very lucrative and important part of the Hammerson portfolio. The Hammerson portfolio is a number of different shopping centres around the country. And they are using Westquay as their test bed for all environmental activities on the basis of the partnership we've been working on for a long time. And in terms of the analysed retail spend, £2.3 billion retail spend within that population. So you're going to get a lot of people coming along and spending a lot of money. Now, each unit in there has got its own electrical supply. Now, this is good and bad for us as far as we're concerned from an environmental management perspective. It means that we can't interfere at all. We can't make any restrictions in terms of patterns, in terms of timing as well. After this, the key point at the end of the day, when the shops are closed and whisky's closed, in terms of the whisky management, we can't actually control what goes on in those units. We can't. What we want is basically a big button that we can press at the end of the day, which goes off. Bang, it's gone. Can't do that. Equally, you can't control the aircon in the different units as well, because they've got their own individual air conditioning units. Why did I say that's a good and a bad thing? Why do you think it's a good and a bad thing from an environmental management perspective? It's a bad thing, clearly, because we can't control what we're doing the shutoff. But why is it a good thing?
Because not everyone has to use them at once if they don't need to.
Exactly, yes. Very good. What else? Think the money. Now, if they just had a service charge to Westkey, where they said, right, we're just going to pay you a lump sum for our electricity, right, then there is no incentive at all for them to reduce their electricity consumption. Yeah? If they're paying for it individually, and you can start getting data and start giving them information and start educating them with the money they're wasting, then all of a sudden there's a financial incentive there. So it's actually a good thing. In the earlier days of Westkey, when we first started working with them, it was a case of there was a central service charge on the electricity provision, but that's changed. So that's actually very useful. Westkey Centre itself is part of the Southampton District Heated Scheme. So you know you see that big politically neutral red and blue box down in Westkey car park, yeah? The geothermal heating scheme. It is actually deliberately painted red and blue because of different political administrations that were around at that time in terms of crossover. So nobody will feel worry about that. That's an entirely different story anyway. The geothermal energy scheme, it hasn't been running for a number of years. It's marketed on this geothermal heating going through there, but it hasn't been operational because the well dried up and there's problems with the pump. But it does still now have a minor contribution in there because hopefully you've re-drilled back in there and it's working again. But that's not the point. The main point is it's fundamentally a combined heat and power plant and it's distributing the combined heat and power network across a very wide area, taking in the city centre in terms of all the shops, taking in the civic centre, etc., etc. Now, another issue you've got to consider here, unit water supply. But in terms of the warming of the water and cooling the water, that's taken part by the district heating scheme. So that's quite useful. But you still need to have mains water for consumption as well. But again, individual unit supply. So again, you've got an incentive. You've got something you can go to the units with. But again, it's all about the data and finding out what's useful. All the retail units, this is where it gets a little bit different then. The waste is an individual service charge. So you can't apply the model that you've got in terms of energy and water to the units for waste. Because whereas you can say, right, we will give you the central electricity area, which is provided by Scottish and Southern Electricity. Yeah. So SSE have got the main electrical unit there, and they've then got a number of charges then go up to the different units. But you get individual metering and you get the charge that way. You can say you've got your own individual charge. But can you have 100 different waste companies coming in on site to collect the waste from 100 different companies? Of course you can't. Just can't be done. Logistically, it's impossible. So you have no option. You have to go for the centralised waste control. The difficulty there is that you then start saying to the organisations, well, we want you to reduce your waste risings, but we're not going to give you any financial incentive to do so. Because they just pay a flat rate through there. So this is a bit more complicated now. So therefore, we need to start getting some data from that, find out what waste has actually been provided and start highlighting some of the main difficult areas, so to speak. When we started the project, recycling rate within Westkey, 30%. So not great. Also, there weren't any recycling points in the main public areas. And that I always found fascinating because people are always lobbying going, and also the students are doing the work of the town and saying, but there's no recycling points in the shopping centre. The actual waste in the shopping centre from the public distributing packaging bits of food there is minuscule compared to the amount of waste that comes from the actual units themselves. The recycling bins in the shopping centre themselves are useful, and they are important because it's part of the whole sustainability message, but in terms of proportion of the waste, it's far, far, far less than 10% of the waste. I think it's below 5%, if I remember correctly. Now, Westkey, part of the Hamilton Corporate Responsibility Strategy, so there is an element here of looking at it from the perspective of the impacts on society. Providing an environment that people want to go to, but without having any sort of elements of community fragmentation, as well as trying to mitigate the impacts on the environment. Now, what happened when we did the EMS for them? As I said earlier, we actually have the module where the module has the students going into the company. Does it make a difference? Do the students just hand in a piece of work to me? I mark it and say, jolly good show. And then they move on and they graduate and give them the degree certificate. No, it's not about that. It's about making sure that the work actually continues to have some resonance and change in the organisation. For Westquay, this partnership approach at the university mattered because they received a manual to the standard of ISO 40001, and within three months, they managed to get the international standard ISO 40001. Now, I think that is a huge, enormous credit to the students. The students are the recipients of that, as far as I'm concerned, not Westquay, not the university, the students. The work they did was phenomenal, absolutely brilliant. To do, for a first attempt at an environmental management system, to do work as good enough that they can take as a company, build it into part of their normal business in terms of their audit programme, then have evidence to go to the international board and say, this is good enough, and then get the international award in 3 months, I think it's fantastic. Huge credit to the students. Now, it's good for the company as well, because they essentially got, well, I used to run an environmental consultancy a few years ago, and I would have typically charged that work out at about 18 to 20 grand. So they got it for a very low total cost. To be fair to them, they did take the students out and wined and dined them after to say thank you and said, go for a meal and thank you, etc. So that sounds nice. They've also now, Hampson as a company, this is what I mean by extended influence of research projects, they've now rolled this out to the rest of their portfolio. So think Bullring Shopping Centre in Birmingham. Ever heard of that one? Massive shopping centre. Bullring has got ISO 40001 purely on the model that our students did. They applied it to that shopping centre. Oracle in Reading got it there as well. Brent Cross Shopping Centre in London, they've got it there as well. So all their portfolio, they've got an environmental management system that applies across the whole of their portfolio, getting 40001 on the basis of the work that our students done there, and we continue to support them on that through the research project that I'm telling you about today in terms of working with Hammerson, but also it's a mere coincidence, I might say, that most of the environmental managers that work in the different shopping centres happen to be graduates of this course as well, because we've got a nice little ongoing relationship there where I can say, they're really good, and it goes out that way. So again, it's got a useful legacy of the university as well. For Westquay, fundamentally, they've got reduced environmental risk, they've got reduced utility cost in terms of their central operations, they've got guaranteed compliance legislation from the information we've given them, but it's then up to them to manage the ongoing compliance legislation. They got lots of publicity out of it. They won a national business award on the basis of this work, and they've got a competitive advantage compared to other shopping centres when they can try to get the greener consumer in as well. Okay? So, this is what Westquay get from the party. What our students get, direct professional experience, presentation skills, writing. This is what I think is the most important one. Practical application theory combined with improved commercial understanding. The ability to be able to go out to employers and say, this is what we can do, this is genuinely what we can do. And they have got that sense of pragmatism built into them from this point onwards. And also, I think it's important that if you're going to spend a lot of time on these types of work, this sort of work, it's got to be something that benefits. You know, you've got to get something out of it personally as well. You can't just do something that's going to be good for you, that's going to be good for the students, just good for the company as well. There's got to be some sort of level of reward for you personally and the university for you to be able to spend time on it and to continue to invest time on it. So we've got something which is very relevant to emerging curriculum. We've got evidence of industrial engagement. We've had lots of consultancy module spin-offs. Every year I run a dissertation project down at Westquay or other shopping centres part of the Hampson portfolio. So future students are then getting research projects out of this as well. And those research projects are in areas such as developing a carbon footprint calculator for the business, doing surveys of consumer attitudes, sustainability, things that feed directly into the business. So we get a lot of spin-off from there. We've also then used some of the consultancy company that I worked with previously in this model, we managed to involve as part of a European Union Framework 7 bid as well. So part of an international 23 university partnership and company partnership project that brings a lot of money into the university, brings a lot of research data and a lot of value into a zero win project, which is all about zero waste to industry in industrial networks. So working with these companies, having that ongoing relationship, does have direct research impacts. And that research project, the zero win one, which some of you went to TED Talks on Sunday would have heard about, Ian Williams is talking about that, is having a massive impact across Europe. Absolutely enormous. So that's what we'd done at the point when we handed the manual over to them. But is there any point in leaving a research project there? Of course there's not. We've got more things to tell you, more slides, how lovely. So in terms of extending the partnership, what you really want to work on is, we've worked with them in terms of ongoing recertification. So when they've had an environment manager there, I then act as a consultant. Obviously I don't get paid for it, I just do as part of the ongoing partnership. And I oversee the whole of their 14,001, making sure it works before they go for the recertification. So keeping that relationship going. There are further six 14,001 systems across the portfolio, as I've already said. And we've also got now a knowledge transfer partnership project and an associate working down there who's employed by the University and Wesky in terms of taking this further. This is where it sits. You've got the relationship between the University of Southampton, Wesky, stroke Hammerson, and the KTP office. KTP, Knowledge Transfer Partnerships, funded by the government and the Technologies Transfer Board. And now within there, you've got a lot of goodwill for creating truly excellent employees for when they finish the project. Because you're looking at a research project that feeds into the university, is of benefit to the company as well. But also, there's a lot of personal development training for the associate as well. It's about creating the business leaders of the future. So it's about university research projects also then helping personal development and professional development, theoretically leading into a better business community as well. In terms of what we're trying to achieve on the KTP, we're really looking at, in the immediate term, ISO 40001 and a corporate social responsibility strategy for Wesky and Hammerson. In terms of the retailers, we're looking at utility consumption and customers, and we're looking at this. This is the most important element of the story. What we're trying to build here is a Wesky and retailers partnership for a toolkit. Because the one thing that I haven't mentioned so far has been about those individual units. I've said about the fact that you've got some incentives or ways to try to work with them, but the 14001 that we operate, when you develop a 14001, you have a scope. You set the scope. You say, this is all about this part of a project. Now, we have to set the scope at that point in time and say, the ISO 40001 is all about the Wesky operations, purely about the Wesky operations, and not including the individual units. Because we couldn't include the individual units because we've got no element of control over them. Because they're responsible for their own management. Yeah? We're not satisfied with that, and this is where the researchers got the further resonance we feel and got the real scope for change. Because we want to create a toolkit that actually gets the retailers to sign up to it and are then embedded into the 14001. Think about the industry. Think about business across the UK. How many shared office sites do you see around industry? How many shared sites where you've got a landlord and you've got multiple occupants? And those multiple occupants are not responsible for their environmental management. It's just taken on by the landlord. Now, there's a lot of sense behind that in terms of the waste logistics, etc. But you lose that sense of responsibility, you get that sense of, you lose that sense of involvement. What we're trying to develop now is a toolkit so you can actually get all the retailers to buy into it. They become part of the system. We then roll that out across the rest of the Hammerson portfolio using Wesky as a testbed. And we then share that with the rest of the retail community. And where I really see the potential is the rest of landlord-owned properties across the business sector across the UK. Because I want this model to change business operations across the country. No big objectives there then. But it's something that has got the potential to really lead change. And it might actually lead to small levels of change in lots of these facilities. But the cumulative effect of those small levels of change are actually quite large. Just like small changes that we make as individuals might not have much resonance on a global scale, but collectively, they're very powerful. And that's the sort of thing that we're looking at here. So what else have we done? Well, we've trained 144 staff, we've got lead auditors, 580 hours of training, and this is where the university relationship really comes in, 62 student volunteers, because part of the power of this partnership as a research project is that we, as I said earlier, we don't just have me going, oh, wouldn't it be nice to look at this research paper and think, oh, how that applies there. That's a bit too much academic navel gazing for my liking. And then saying to the person out there, just apply this. It's not about that, it's about doing things differently. And by using student volunteers to collect data, what you're doing is you're training students to be energy auditors. They can put on their CV. You're training students to be waste auditors. They can put on their CVs and their skills development. Not only would they put on their CVs in terms of helping them get a job in the environment sector, they might not want the job in the environment sector. But if they understand these processes, when they go into their day-to-day work, even if it's not in the environment sector, they've already got the skills and their mindsets. So it then feeds out into other industrial sectors as well. That's the idea behind it. We want more student volunteers to take part in this. I was going to show you some photos of the work we've been doing, but I haven't got permissions to show inside the retail units, back of house, things like that. But we've done big waste audits. We had 25 students go down and sorted through all the waste in the Westquay Skips on one day. Now, doesn't sound very glamorous. I love it personally. But the point is, what you're then finding is what types of waste have been disposed of and what you need to do in the way of intervention, changing your waste management infrastructure within the business. Now, you can't do that if you just got me and the associate, Jenny, doing the work, because we'll only be able to go through a small number of bins. You get a huge number of students going through there and get other staff involved as well. Obviously, you can do all the waste risings in one skip in just 1 or 2 hours. Do you know what the biggest waste rising we found was? Have a guess. And I want a specific, accurate answer, and Julia's not allowed to answer because she knows the answer. Sorry?
Polystyrene,
no. This is going to break the heart of a lot of people in the audience. Krispy Kreme donuts. We had huge bags, huge black bin bags. You open them, Krispy Kreme donuts, all of them, all intact, in boxes, everything. Open another one, Krispy Kreme donuts. Risk assessment meant that we could not let anybody touch any of them. So you had these poor students just weeping at the inhumanity of the whole situation. Just going, can I just take one? No, you can't take just one. It's in a bin. Think about what you're asking. But you know, lots of them in boxes as well, and they were all fully bagged. But it highlights the part of the problem is, and this isn't a criticism of Krispy Kreme at all. It's part of this whole drive by consumers to insist that everything's just fresh on the day. Because when things aren't finished off, they go straight in the bin because the company policy is driven on fresh on the day of purchase. Now, you can blame the company for that. That's actually down to us as consumers for demanding that in terms of it's got to be fresh on the day of purchase. Same with Pret. Pret, if they've got anything left over in the day, it has to go straight in the bin because it's all fresh on the day of purchase. So we actually drive that, so we can't criticise them for that. But it's quite telling that it tells you what's actually happening and how you're going to address it. Sorry.
I was just going to say, to what extent would you have any control over enabling retailers to be participants in schemes? I know Marks and Spencers, for example, they have schemes where they can give some of their food to charities, can't they?
Yeah.
So is that outside of your remit, or can you help them to try their company policy to change and be more flexible and give food to charities?
Used to give it away.
Yeah.
I think they changed, did they?
They officially they still do, but they always manage their stock brilliantly, to be fair to them. So they do reduce the amount of... Fred, one of the companies where you'd actually like to see quite a bit of food left over the day, so it could actually be given out to charities. That would be a good thing.
The central hall church actually arranges for stuff left at Pret on a Sunday to be picked up and distributed.
Great. Brilliant example of community sustainability. That's fantastic. But yeah, you're right. And it's about putting influence on them, but you can only influence through going to a head office, the individual practice there. But you've also got to think about waste regulations as well. Because you have to get a permit to be able to do that. So you have to get a permit through the Environment Agency if you're going to be able to do that, because technically it's waste. And you can't just give up waste because you lose your duty, you're handing over your duty of care. So there's lots of intricacies here you've got to think about and consider. It's actually quite difficult. So we've done the waste audits, we've got the volunteers to help through that. We've also done baseline audits of going through all the different retail units to find out what they've got in their stores in the way of lighting, etc., and what they're actually doing in terms of their environmental management. So the sort of thing that would take us about a month to do by going to all the different individual retail units, we did in a whole morning by getting the students to help out with us and working through the forms. And do you know what we rewarded them with? There's a theme developing here, by the way. Absolutely. So what we found from the retailer reviews was, apart from nice donuts, 38% of retailers have actually provided some form of environmental training to the staff, which is quite a surprise. 20% have tried to reduce water. 61% have tried to reduce their overall energy consumption, but they want us to work with them. 41% of stores had fewer than 25% of their lights being energy efficient. Some of the worst ones being, I can't really name names, I'm being filmed. I'll tell you later when the camera's off. None of them had actually monitoring and measuring available on site. 54% interested in completing a full review. And this is really vital to us because we've now got a way in. And if you've got a way in, we can then work with these companies, show the retailers what they're doing, help improve their systems, they then start working. And competition in the retail environment is really fierce because we've also got evidence that retailers, that consumers want to buy from sustainable organisations. Whether they will actually do that is by the by. We want to give them evidence that says they are actually interested and let them make their own decisions from there. But if you've got that competition element and some organisations are actually doing something, then you can really use that as incentive to get others on board. So the fact that we've got this is great. So we are now starting to work with them and we're then looking at the trickle-down effect from there. The more we can have competition, the better. And 79% wish to understand how they're doing compared to others. So that reinforces my point. They're interested in competition as a driver. So you've got to find your way in and then you exploit that way in. Exploit being a harsh word, but it's true. So what have we had? We've had 591 hours. Now, since the project started, we've gone from 30% recycling up to nearly 80% recycling. What does that mean? Is that actually 166% increase in waste recycling, which is great, absolutely fantastic, and we think that's brilliant. How do we find that through? By looking at the waste streams that are coming through and then going back to the contractor and saying, what should we do but optimising collection, segregation on site, that would allow us to maximise recycling. Working not just with the retail units, but also working with the waste contractor as well. Looking at the whole chain. Don't just work in isolation, think of the totality and look at the waste contractor and what they're going to do there and work with them to make sure that they can maximise their segregation. That's how you maximise recycling. And that's exactly what we do here in the university as well, as to why our recycling rates are going through the roof. 10% less carbon emissions through the whole of Westquay than 2010, 4% less water usage, one green roof, it's almost like a Christmas poem or something, one citywide biodiversity, oh, shocking name, biodiversity group, nothing to do with me, that name, I hasten to add, absolutely nothing whatsoever. As said, Harmison, we got direct environmental science employees and the environmental management retailer toolkit that we're hoping to launch November, December time. When I say hoping to launch, the funding runs out. We've got no choice. We've got to launch it then. Toolkit. What we're really looking to try to do is reduce utility consumption, improve the environment awareness of staff and consumers, and alter the supply chain decisions, which is what you can allude to just now. Roll out across Harmison. And also it's got wider sector applicability, as I've already said. Now, when we're talking here about the environmental impact, when you look at those headlines, the one thing I didn't mention here was customer travel. This comes back to the start of the talk. See, I told you I'd get there eventually when we started talking all these hours ago. The travel is really something that's critical to this, because you can look at the 166% increase in recycling. You can talk about reduction in water. You can talk about the reduction in carbon emissions. But how do you quantify the carbon emissions? It goes back to what I was saying earlier about our carbon emissions nationally not necessarily accounting for the production in other countries. So are we accounting our carbon correctly? Is that correct? Because if you think of it in these terms, now, these are making some assumptions now, but I think they're fairly safe assumptions. Assuming that 3 out of every 4 Westquay journeys are by car, and you average it out as a medium-sized family car, with 3 passengers in. So each visitor, you're not just counting them as an individual car journey, you're counting 3 visitors in 1 car journey, okay, on average. So of those 16 million odd visitors, then you're really looking it down, boiling it down into approximately 4 million car journeys. That might be low. I'm not sure. A lot of people go there individually, but these are just broad assumptions. 4 million car journeys, assuming an average journey of 10 miles each way, which is probably longer than that if you think of the overall catchment, then you get 80 million miles of customer travel a year. From that 80 million miles of customer travel a year, that actually equates to 34.4 million kilograms of carbon dioxide per year. On a rough calculation basis, we can't get fully accurate data for this. You have to make assumptions. Now that, as I said, is only based on 4 million car journeys of the 16 million visitors that go to the site. Don't know whether that's accurate. Don't know where. What do you think? Do you think, let's play Bruce's player cards right. Do we feel higher or lower? People think higher. Okay, fine. Perhaps I was being conservative then. Perhaps I've been optimistic. Because the point is, should West Key... There you go. It depends how you spin the figures as well. This is what I really like. Look at that. It's terrifying. 34.4 million kilograms. 0.034 metric tons per year. In terms of when you look at metric tons being converted from kilograms, it doesn't seem that much. But the reality is, it's still a considerable amount of journey, still a considerable carbon emission. Because it is the elephant in the room. What we don't discuss when we're talking about environmental management, in all the West Key meetings we've had over the years, and all the HAMS meetings, we don't talk about the customer travel, because we say, well, it's up to them when they get to us. It's up to them when we get there. But it is undoubtedly the elephant in the room. Not a rhino, but a proper elephant. In terms of citing your sources for images, do you know where I got this site, this image? This is, to my eternal shame, the UKIP website. I wasn't looking at UKIP, I just happened to do a search for elephants in rooms, and we came up with this. Quite random, really. So do you think that's meant to be Europe, then? Don't know. So what I'd like us to discuss, not now, but after these fine ladies have spoken, when we're talking about the wider retail and sustainability, is the focus of this project correct? Should retailers be changing the perspectives? Do you make sustainable purchase decisions, transport decisions? Can we change consumer attitudes? Because the most interesting things here are travel and also fashion, sustainable fashion, which leads us into... So thank you. We're finished. Sorry, I overran by 10 minutes in the end. Sorry. I was meant to be 45, I did 55.
Okay, wow. Where to follow that? We're going to talk to you a bit more about the fashion. And ethical fashion side of retail. My name's Ellie Tighe, and this is Emma Waight, and we're both PhD students here at the University of Geography.
Yeah, and our talk is kind of based on a workshop that we ran a couple of weeks ago. Ethical fashion is something that we're both really passionate about, and it's something that we all have an influence on because we all buy clothing, unless someone buys it for us, but we all, I hope, certainly wear clothing most of the time. And the retail industry is a huge contributor to the British economy, but as all of us know, very few clothes are actually made in the UK anymore. Most of the clothing in our wardrobes will have come through a long and complex supply chain from fibre to garment before reaching us, passing through two or three countries and probably countless hands. And the more research both of us have done, the more complex we see the issue to be. It's very difficult to know what is right or wrong, what are the right or wrong things to buy. I personally think it's a lot easier when you're thinking about environmental sustainability, because I believe as humans we shouldn't have a negative impact on environmental ecosystems. But with social issues it's more complicated when perhaps countries are developing at different rates and practices are really embedded within local cultures. So the ethical fashion industry is growing. It's still a small niche compared to the whole UK retail industry, but it's certainly improving year by year.
So back in November, Emma and I decided to hold a small workshop to discuss these issues, and today we're going to present to you some of those findings. We were aware that there had been a number of workshops being organised around the country, but often these come from sort of fashion and designer face, place, and we thought that there was space for people to come together from more diverse backgrounds. So we got early careers professionals, people with an interest, and also early careers researchers together about 3 weeks ago now. And yeah, that's what we're going to present to you today.
So when we were asked to give this talk, we were asked to give a bit about our backgrounds as well. We're both in the geography department doing PhD studies, but I came from a fashion background. So I did an undergraduate degree in fashion promotion, and I became interested in ethical fashion during my second year. And I chose the topic of that topic for my final year dissertation. And by the time I graduated, I was completely disillusioned with the industry, really. After wanting to work in fashion for as long as I could remember, I suddenly didn't really know what to do anymore. So I was lucky enough to be invited back to uni to actually work on an ethical fashion project, and we worked with two case study companies during that time, one of which was Continental Clothing, who were the first company to carbon footprint a t-shirt and have a fully traceable supply chain. And I also completed an MPhil degree where I looked at sustainable supply chains and consumer behaviour. And this led to my PhD, now here at the University of Southampton, where I'm not specifically studying fashion anymore, but I am studying clothing to a certain extent. I'm looking at baby clothes and toys and equipment. I'm looking at secondhand retail and what this can tell us about parenting practices and wider social practices. But I'm still really involved with ethical fashion, and I run a blog and do work for Oxfam Fashion as well, which is why I wanted to get involved with putting on an event with Ellie.
So my background is slightly different to Emma's. I've always been in the geography department. I was a human geographer where I did my BA. And then I took some time out and I did more sort of voluntary work overseas. And then I went and did a master's in international political economy. So my research interest is in these issues relating to international development, fair trade, ethical production, and workers' rights, and how these issues play out together. My research, my PhD research, is titled Regulatory Frameworks and Institutional Responses, and looks specifically at the Bangladeshi garment industry. And what I'm interested in looking at is how, like, developing countries utilise the opportunities made available as a result of clothing production, and the relationship between economic growth on one hand and then these issues of workers' rights abuses and poor regulation of labour standards on the other. Moving on from that, I'm also interested in the emergence of voluntary governance mechanisms. So voluntary governance mechanisms are these initiatives that are coordinated by NGOs, which help retailers and brands make their supply chains more manageable and help them govern their supply chain so that they can be more ethical for the workers. And how these initiatives, which are mostly thought out and a product of Western NGOs, how they coordinate their operations on the ground, which stakeholders they engage, and the local politics and issues related to that. So my research is based on 6 months ethnographic fieldwork, which I did out in Bangladesh last year, and I'll talk probably a little bit more about that later on in the presentation.
So it all starts at the beginning of the supply chain, and that is the raw material, which is the fibre, which gets turned into fabric. And you've got three main types of fibres. You've got natural fibres like cotton, silk, wool. You've got synthetic or man-made fibres, usually from petrochemicals like acrylic or polyester. And you've got regenerated fibres as well, which come about through a processing of natural resources. For example, viscose comes from wood cellulose. And all fibres have their advantages and disadvantages. It's not necessarily that natural fibres are good and synthetic fibres are bad. Some of the environmental concerns we have are resource consumption, greenhouse gas emissions, air and water pollution, and soil degradation or contamination. And some of the social concerns are workers' rights, farmers living in poverty, health and safety, and also animal welfare, which we don't really touch upon much here, in use of fur, etc., but that obviously is a part of the industry. So if we take cotton as an example, Cotton gets quite a lot of press. It might often be considered a good natural fibre. It constitutes the basis for many of our textile products and many of our clothes because it's breathable, it's versatile, it's comfortable to wear, it's hard wearing. But there are a number of issues involved in cotton agriculture. So you've got the intensive use of chemical pesticides and fertilisers, which can disrupt natural ecosystems, get washed into waterways, but also cause problems for the farmers that perhaps either don't have the money to buy protective clothing or don't have the education or awareness about the dangers of using such chemicals. Cotton is a very thirsty crop, so it has a huge water footprint and it's also very susceptible to climatic changes. There are problems with soil erosion and over-intensified farming if farmers feel under pressure to produce certain yields each year for suppliers. And this all, many of these issues lead to farmers living in poverty. Suicides aren't uncommon, particularly with Indian cotton farmers, when they find themselves actually trapped in debt. And there have been a number of high-profile issues that we've seen through the cotton industry. So we've got the loss of the Aral Sea, big lake bordering Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan, and that occurred, an area that was once a really prosperous fishing industry, through inefficient irrigation of the nearby cotton fields. That industry has now almost disappeared, or at least suffered. You've got issues with indolcifan, which was or is a very toxic pesticide which causes deformities and death, so this is being phased out now or banned in certain places, many places. And then you've got Uzbekistan cotton, where schools are closed during the harvest season and children are forced to go and work in the cotton fields harvesting the cotton. Many retailers ban Uzbek cotton from their supply chains, but as supply chains are so complex, it's really difficult to actually trace this. And 10% of the world's cotton harvest is Uzbek cotton, so again, many of us probably actually own some of this. And it contributes 20% towards the country's GDP. So whether we should boycott it is a difficult issue, actually. But there are ethical alternatives, and as part of our workshop day, we had a speaker, Charlie Ross, who runs Offset Warehouse, which he set up a couple of years ago to supply ethical and sustainable fabrics, both to quite large retailers as well as individuals. And you've obviously got organic and fair trade cotton, and H&M and Walmart are the biggest users of organic cotton worldwide. And there's actually not really currently enough organic cotton to meet demand. You've got colour grown cotton, so this is actually naturally how cotton occurs, is that it already has a certain hue to it, a natural colour, so it doesn't have to be dyed. And you've got hemp, nettle, flax, bamboo increasingly being used, milk fibre, so that's quite silky fibre, it's actually possible, similarly soy, and also fibres made from corn.
So moving on to from the early stages of the supply chain, the afternoon's discussion then went on to the more outsourced and the cut and stitch manufacturing. Since the 1980s, high street retailers have outsourced their fashion production into developing countries, and very few garments are now made here in the UK. You only have to look at the label on your clothes to realise that they're coming all over the world. So I think my jumper comes from China and my skirt comes from Indonesia, and I don't even know where my tights and my shoes come from. So between 1970 and 1990, the number of textiles and clothing workers in Bangladesh increased by 416%. The number in Sri Lanka increased by 384%. And I've got some other statistics here. China now employs about 5.3 million workers. And globally, this industry is estimated to employ about 23.6 million workers. But actually, the number is a lot higher because a lot of the employment is in informal industries, and there's further industries indirectly. So the reason that you're seeing a lot of this is that these developing country governments see that the jobs and the opportunities that are made from clothing production is the first step on the ladder to economic growth and development. And the amount of jobs that these countries get from this means that a lot of young women and young men get a work and employment. And it's a really big first stage on the step for diversifying national economic activity. However, at the same time, in these countries, you're seeing cases of sweatshops and labour rights abuses, and you hear tales in the media of dark, dingy workhouses, fires, poor health and safety standards, long working hours, and poverty wages. And obviously, the issues which give rise to these situations are really, really complex and more than just issues of poor regulation. So at the global level, at our level, our demand for fast fashion, cheap clothing, the seasonality. We used to have four seasons and now we have six. And we want our clothes cheap. If you're going to a shop and you're only paying £5 for a t-shirt, when you account for fabric costs, for transport costs, for the cost of the managers, all these other things, the amount of money that makes it down to the worker is going to be really small in proportion. And also, in these areas, you get a lot of competition and bargaining. So if you take Dhaka, for example, there's over 8,000 garment-producing factories, and they compete within themselves. So these retailers and these buyers will operate a sourcing office in the local area, and they'll meet with all the different manufacturers and they'll bargain the price till they get it at the cheapest price, just like we do when we go to the high street and we buy a product. So you also get high levels of local competition pushing down on prices. At the same time, in these countries, you don't have industrial relations systems in operation, and if they do, they're very immature and poorly developed. So often, something as simple as just explaining that the company might not have the money there to pay you the wages this week, where they could have just explained that with the workers from the first place, It doesn't happen. So that can trigger worker unrest and worker violence, and they'll just take to the streets and people will get hurt. You may get regulation, or you may get labour law. Sometimes you don't have labour law. In a lot of these countries in South Asia, for example, the labour law comes from the colonial period and it hasn't been updated. And the government change it really quickly so that it reflects their interest. So, example, the law on trade union regulations in Bangladesh, you have to, for the union to be formally recognised as a legal entity, you have to get a third of the workforce to sign up for membership, and then you have to register that union with the government, which if you're in a workplace of about 10 people, that means that you have to get six people to organise into a union. But if you're in a workplace of 10,000 people, it's a lot more difficult. And also, there's been local labour movements have reason to believe that the government are sort of not actually allowing these registrations to go through. They're finding fault in the applications. And then you have the issue of low levels of education amongst the workforce. They come from the rural areas, they don't know what's right, they don't know what's wrong, they don't know their labour rights. And the managers don't take them in and teach them their labour rights, so they don't know what's the correct process to go. And you get this global competition rhetoric between the managers and the workers, that they make the workers aware that if they are doing these certain things and then the wages rise or there's labour unrest, then the industry will up sticks and move to the next best competitor. And often the government and the industry is believed to kind of be in this complicit relationship together, with many members of the government actually owning the factories. But while all this is happening, the clothes are still being made, so the suppliers can still go there and they can still get the product, and it kind of fits in what they want. So at the moment, the best system of regulation, or the only system of regulation, is these buyers codes of conduct, which the buyers, as a response to the campaign of like anti-sweatshop movement, have then influenced or input into their supply chain. So here's an example of a code of conduct, which somewhere like Primark or H&M or all these companies will use. They agree to no forced labour in their supply chain, respect for freedom of association and collective bargaining to form a union, safe and hygienic work conditions, no child labour, fair wages, no excessive overtime, no discrimination, and informal or formal employment contracts. However, one of our talks in the afternoon, Dr. Kanchana Rampura, based here at the University of Southampton, brought our attention to the fact that often these codes of conduct, when they're put into place, are very poorly carried out. And this was based on her own field research in Pakistan and Sri Lanka. So what happens with these codes of conduct, often they're placed in a language in the workplace that the workers can't understand, so they'll be placed in English rather than in Urdu. And managers create a culture of fear that if workers like use the codes of conduct, then they'll lose their jobs. And often men in the workplace have a bigger awareness of what these codes of conduct are as opposed to women, so women will actively be recruited so that they don't sort of use the code to obtain their rights. And also there's a discrepancy between which codes are upheld, so payment of a wage, no employment of child labour, as opposed to freedom of association and collective bargaining. These codes on one hand are held while the others don't so much. However, our final talk of that session was from a consultancy based here in the UK called Impact. They're an ethical retail consultancy, and they've got offices based in China, India, and Bangladesh. And they put a more sort of positive spin on this story, saying that the opportunities for development that come from these industries are obviously a good thing, and trade can be really good for developing countries, but you need to facilitate this dialogue and this approach. And what is required is for buyers and retailers in this country and in the West to work more closely with their suppliers to know that how these approaches work. So you can do things like you can cut-to-ship ratio, so that everything that gets made makes it onto the ship, so that you get less wastage, and then you can return that back to the workers so that wages increase. And then teaching human resources management strategies like how to communicate, how to negotiate, how to put your demands in a way that won't cause agitation. So it's basically about changing attitudes on the ground, which brings us back here to the UK and what we can do. So I can carry on.
So as part of our multidisciplinary approach to our workshop day, we also looked at law, and we had a speaker come in who is a law lecturer at Hertfordshire University, and we looked at whether the British government has a role to play in this. So the terms like eco, sustainable and ethical are all used interchangeably, but there is currently no legal definition in place to actually protect consumers. This can lead to consumer confusion, consumers being misled, brands perhaps accused of greenwashing. So there is this lack of transparency there, and it's open to misinterpretation. It might surprise you, for example, that country of origin labelling isn't compulsory, isn't mandatory for garments, and many brands do choose to use it, as we all see inside our clothes labels. But what we probably should be more worried about is what they're choosing not to put on those labels. And I think the fashion industry could learn quite a lot from the food industry. Perhaps not the best example considering recent events, but generally there are more regulations in place with food labelling, and we have more information available to us as consumers when we go out and do our food shopping as compared to our clothes shopping. There have also been talks by the British Fashion Council to perhaps give tax breaks for ethical clothing brands or ethical clothes, but in general, ethical products must be able to stand up against the broader industry. It's no good just being ethical. And in that sense, retailers need to become more competitive and market ethical fashion in a way that it becomes a conscious purchase and a consumer chosen consumer lifestyle, really, rather than just a fad that's going to go out of fashion. So just last Tuesday, this week, there was actually a debate in the House of Lords about what we can do to promote ethics and sustainability in fashion. And I think this shows that it is on the government's agenda. And I'd recommend catching up on that if it interests anybody. You can find it on parliamentlive.tv, I think. One thing perhaps they could do is lead by example and actually ensure that public sector uniforms are procured ethically. Because when we're talking about fashion, I mean, really, when we talk about ethical fashion, we're talking about the whole clothing industry often. But there are issues to do with promotional clothing and corporate wear, like uniforms, where actually sometimes some of the worst practices are hiding because they're not picked up on by the media and they're not such well publicised. Okay. And I'm kind of just going to finish by jumping right to the end of the product life cycle, picking up on some of the things that Simon talked about earlier, actually, and linking into my current research, which is about secondhand consumption. And if we're talking about ethical fashion or ethical consumerism, clearly the most sustainable thing we can do is actually to buy less. So I think we should be buying fewer clothes, but buying better quality. It's not a particularly new message. But what we need to do is try and understand consumer behaviour better so that we can encourage habits to be changed. And I think if we are, as consumers, looking to buy better quality, to buy less, this will actually force retailers to change their business models so that instead of basing their whole business plan around selling high quantities of cheap, fast fashion, perhaps they will actually look into more sustainable, better quality alternatives. Perhaps retailers have a part to play in encouraging this as well, with providing alteration services or encouraging swishing events. So I think we've got £140 million of used clothing goes to landfill each year. And so we really need to encourage consumers to think about what they've already got at home in their wardrobes. So we recently put on the swap shop here at the university, which was a great way for people to make use of clothing and swap it in a sustainable and free way. That could be a model for other universities or businesses to follow. And Oxfam estimates that 2.4 billion items of clothing are sitting in our wardrobes unused and unloved, which is clearly quite wasteful. So some of my research has been looking at, as I said, consumer behaviour, and there is a small but growing area of academic research that I hope to build on, looking at what motivations and rationalisations consumers have for buying secondhand. And I've found it's quite an emotive issue. Some people are very much brought up on having things secondhand. So for some people, it's completely unacceptable. There's obviously a risk factor involved in buying items secondhand. So there's issues to do with whether it's fit for purpose, but also the fact that it has a pre-inscribed biography to it. It has a history to it. You don't know where it's been, who's worn it in the case of clothing, what has happened to it. And sometimes this can be seen as a positive consumer trait, because consumers like that inbuilt authenticity, and perhaps they're looking for something different. And sometimes, obviously, it can be seen more as a negative. But the literature generally agrees that financial motivations are still primary for consumers. So they will generally be buying secondhand items, or perhaps procuring them for free through free cycle or hand-me-downs. But it is mainly financial motivations, either due to actual financial necessity or because of the satisfaction gained from saving money. But increasingly, we are starting to see more ethical and politicised motivations for this practice. So it might be that consumers want to try and avoid corporate retailers. They want to beat the system. They want to provide, they want to buy more ethical and sustainable alternatives as well. So,
to conclude, is ethical fashion by its nature an oxymoron? Can something which has been based on trend really be made more ethical? Well, if you take fashion as relating to clothing, then yes, I think actually there can. And obviously, consumers, we ourselves, have a big role to play in this, because where consumers lead, the brands will follow. If we demand a product that has been made as in the best environment and social conditions as possible, then that's going to be a marketable product that the brands are going to want to make, and therefore there's a profit there in producing it. And all of this is, of course, highly complex and needs a collaborative effort from stakeholders across the board. And it seems like this whole ethics or the current systems of practice are based on established conventions and practices, and to buy ethically or to conduct our practice ethically needs a change in these in conventions, which has to start with the consumer.
And we also believe it needs to be inbuilt into education of future industry professionals. So in 2011, there were 18,000 students registered on fashion courses in the UK. Our fashion education is fairly well recognised and leading across the world. So it's important that ethics and sustainability is embedded into those programmes. And linking back to Ellie's first point as well about where consumers lead, brands will follow, consumers need educating. And it's about how we can make it a more high profile issue. For example, apparently 73% of us will say that we'll buy free range eggs, which obviously doesn't have any direct impact on our health. It's going to probably cost us more money. So why do we do it? It's almost that it's become a social convention that we will buy free range eggs, most of us. So do we need someone like Jamie Oliver, who's going to cheerlead this ethical fashion effort and actually get it more into mainstream, like we're starting to see with the food industry? Thank you.
Thank you.